Hari Om. Let's start with the prayer. Om Samasta Jana Kalyani Niratam Karunamayam Namami Chinmayam Devam Sadgurum Brahma Vidvaram Vasudeva Sutam Devam Kamsachano Ramadhanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagadgurum Tvameva Mata Cha Pitattvameva Tvameva Bandhuscha Sakhattvameva Tvameva Vidya Dravidam Tvameva Tvameva Sarvam Amadeva Deva Tvameva Sarvam Gurudeva Deva. Hari Om. We are doing the question and answer sessions, and now today we ask the question. It says, how can Vedas be Apouresheaya? This is a common question a lot of people ask. It says, Apouresheaya means not written by a human being. How can Vedas not written by a human being? And the first thing we need to know that it is the Hindus' faith that the Vedas are beginningless and therefore they are not written by a human being. Number one. Number two, because they are not written by a human being, they are the ultimate pramana, means ultimate source of knowledge, because anything written by a human being will have defects and can be biases and opinions and all that. So there is no question of any bias or opinion here. It's only taken for granted. If Vedas say so, it must be so. That is the fact. And that's why the faith in the Hinduism is essentially Vedas are Apouresheaya. Now, how can that be? Is it just a blind belief? Let's look at it a little carefully. It says, Veda actually means science, we just mentioned. And any science is a knowledge. And knowledge is the beginningless. It says, knowledge means knowledge is that which cannot be negated. That's called Brahma. Say Pramakaranam Pramanam. Pramana means of knowledge, it reveals the knowledge, and knowledge is that which cannot be negated. That's what the definition of knowledge is. And this knowledge has to be beginningless as per our logic also. Why? Even a scientist, when you say he discovered this, he discovered that which is there in the creation. Discovery means removing the cover. That means a scientist only removing cover, and when you remove a cover, what is there will get revealed. And therefore, what is there is a science, which is the knowledge, which is always there. So science or knowledge is eternal, and Veda means science and means knowledge, and it is eternal. So therefore, there is no writing of Vedas. And therefore, even a scientist only discovering, removing the cover, in the same way, our Vedic masters or the scientists of the Vedas of the yore, called rishis, or they claim that it is revealed to them. So revelations is what they call the Vedas. So the rishis of the yore are called Veda drashtas. When Vishwamitra says he did not write the Gayatri Japam or Gayatri Mantra, it is revealed to him in the seat of meditation. And that's essentially revelations which they passed it on to their disciples, and the disciples learn by listening to this teacher, and that's why it's called Shruti. Shruti means listening to a teacher, and what is this science or knowledge, and they passed down to the next generation, to their students, and their students, when they became teachers, passed it on. Therefore, there is a guru parampara. It is from the beginning, it has been coming, and the very source is ultimately the Lord himself, because he is the creator of everything. So even the Lord also claims that it is the Vedas that was there already. It's being passed on to humanity, and that's what Krishna claims. I taught this to Vivaswan before and all that, now I am teaching you again. So it was a beginningless knowledge that is passed on. Therefore, from the knowledge point also, there is a beginningless. If you ask the question, who wrote physics? What do you mean, who wrote physics? Oh, physics, see, we are reading physics, we are reading chemistry. Who wrote physics or who wrote chemistry. There is no particular person who wrote physics, because there are many scientists contributed, and it's a collection of the discoveries of all the scientists, what we call learned as a physics. And therefore, it's Apouresheaya only. But we accept as though physics wrote somebody. In the same way, the Vedas are also passed on by adding all the great masters have put forth, and it is a collection of the revelations of this. And once Chandrasekhar, the Nobel laureate Chandrasekhar, made a statement in Scientific American. He said, all scientific discoveries are made in intuition, he said. What is intuition? You cannot define intuition. Intuition is suddenly that strikes to the mind. When a scientist is contemplating or meditating on a subject, and the knowledge gets revealed, and the scientist may say, I made a breakthrough. That means I discovered it. Whereas same thing happens to a rishi, he says, he doesn't say I discovered it, he says it is revealed to me. So in both cases, it's a revelations. One is objective knowledge, and other is the total knowledge, absolute knowledge, and that is called Veda. And Vedanta, we defined it as the ultimate science. And therefore, it's a revelations of the great masters that are passed on by generation to generation, and that's called the Shruti. And Veda Vyasa, he saw that these things are getting passed on by word of mouth, is getting maybe distorted or maybe getting lost. So he collected all that is available and put them into four volumes. So Veda Vyasa did not write Vedas. He only collected, is called first editor. He edited into four volumes, and each volume is one Veda. So there are four Vedas, and in the Vedas, the first part is called Karma Kanda, and the second part is called Jnana Kanda. Karma Kanda involves basically all what one has to do, get what something else. So if you want something else, you need a process, just like cooking book, where if you want to make something, sambar, you need to add this, you need to add this, you need all that. So recipe. By reading cooking book, nothing will happen. You have to follow the instructions as it is said in the cooking book. Same way, the Karma Kanda, you have to follow the instructions and perform the karma according to the instructions, then you will get result. That's what the Karma Kanda. But the last part of the Vedanta is called Jnana Kanda, where the Upanishads are put in the form of the philosophical discussions, and that's called Upanishads. And so in the Vedanta philosophy, and there are 500 and something Upanishads, and there are new Upanishads being inserted as though it is original, like Allah Upanishad and all that. That is to give some kind of authenticity to the teachings of other masters. But Vedanta is very specific, and they are also very authentic. Upanishads are also there, and that's what has to be understood. So Vedanta and Vedas are Apouresheyam. So knowledge is Apouresheyam, and also the source of knowledge also. And it's written in such a way with swaras and all that, no one can interject into something into the Vedanta or Vedas, and therefore it's preserved in a very tight way. And we have to really thank our great masters who put it on so that it can be passed on to generation to generation. So that explains why Vedanta is called Vedas are called Apouresheyam. With that, we stop here. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamiva Visishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.